Welcome to the 24th video of Quantum Mechanics Done Right, the shortest path from novice to researcher. In this video, we're going to be talking about Chapter 18, which is on the Hubbard model. You have here on the left a picture of Hubbard. You can see those circles are latticites and those little arrows are electrons that are sitting on the latticites. He's actually giving a lecture about the Hubbard model itself. The Hubbard model involves electrons that can hop from one site to another site on a lattice, and when the two electrons sit on the same site, they feel a Coulomb repulsion given by U. It sounds like a really simple model, but it is defied solution except in one dimension by the beta ansatz and in infinite dimensions by something called dynamical mean field theory. Both of those particular solutions are a bit too complicated for us to put into the book, even though we've already talked about beta ansatz previously. Chapter 18, the Hubbard model. What we do with the Hubbard model is we first introduce the model and talk about it, and then we have to look at the different symmetries. There is a spin symmetry because the electrons, when they hop from site to site, they don't flip their spin. So the total spin, total angular momentum, and z component of angular momentum are both conserved in the model. There's also a symmetry called a pseudo-spin symmetry. This only occurs when you have a bipartite lattice. And if you recall, a bipartite lattice is a lattice where I can separate my lattice into two sublattices and I only hop from one sublattice to the other sublattice. In that case, this pseudo-spin symmetry is another interesting result and an interesting symmetry that you have in the system. It relates to changing of particle number, and it relates energy eigenstates that have additional pairs of electrons in them. They have the same energy as with one fewer pair, and then the energy is reduced by a U, exactly U. One of the techniques we use to solve these problems is small cluster solutions. That means you take a lattice, and instead of having something close to Avogadro's number of latticites, we have, say, two latticites, or four latticites, or eight latticites. And then we try and solve the problem exactly on that smaller size cluster. You can learn a lot of interesting things about the many-body physics and the solutions of the Hubbard model by doing that, but of course it doesn't give you everything. Next up, we have a theorem that says when you take a half-filled band, which means on average, every latticite has one electron. Each latticite can have at most two electrons on it. But if you have, on average, one electron per site, that's called half-filling. If you remove one electron and the interactions are very strong, then the system has to have a transition into a ferromagnetic state. And it's a very interesting theorem. It's proven with the Perron-Frobenius theorem, and we go through all the details of that. Then we go and we talk about a property called spin reflection positivity. This is a result that Elliott Leeb figured out in working on the Hubbard model, and as a result of it, he proved two theorems in 1989 about the Hubbard model that were very influential and important, and we're going to talk in detail about that work, and it leads to something that's called spin towers and pseudo-spin towers. This is a problem that's been partially solved, but not completely solved, and I'll tell you about some of the aspects of the problem, how the problem that has been solved was solved, and what remains to be solved. It's a very interesting problem about how energy eigenstates might be ordered according to certain quantum numbers. All right, let's go browse through the chapter. Our quote for this chapter comes from Michelle Obama, former First Lady of the United States. The only limit to the height of your achievements is the reach of your dreams and your willingness to work hard for them. In quantum mechanics, you got to work hard, but everyone can understand quantum mechanics, so you just have to be able to put the time and the energy in. So we start off with an introduction to the Hubbard model. If you remember, we covered tight binding in the previous chapter. Here we have that tight binding model plus this extra term that involves a Coulomb repulsion between two electrons when they sit at the same site. You can think of this as a screened Coulomb interaction because in metals the electrons tend to screen each other out. Here we have that image of Hubbard. You can also look at the Hubbard model in momentum space. When you do that, the hopping term becomes particularly simple, but the interaction term becomes an unholy mess, and so often we don't actually work with it in momentum space, but there are some circumstances where working in momentum space is actually beneficial. We then talk about the bipartite lattice. We look at what is called particle hole symmetry and partial particle hole symmetry. We also look at total spin and then something called pseudospin as well, and how those operators, so here's our section that talks about those specific symmetries, spin, pseudospin, and the number operator. A lot of this is really just some operator gymnastics and commutators. You have to verify that certain operators commute with a Hamiltonian, and then that means that you have good quantum numbers. In some cases, like with pseudospin, it doesn't exactly commute, but it acts like a raising or lowering operator, so you know what happens then to the energies when you look at states that have been raised or lowered by the pseudospin raising and lowering operators. Then we go into great detail and solve the two-site Hubbard model. This might sound like a simple thing to do, but it actually provides a lot of interesting results in how you can simplify things. So you start off with a system that has a 256 by 256 matrix, and you can reduce it down to at most having to solve a 2x2 matrix. It's pretty remarkable how you use symmetries to do this, and so we carefully go through and explain how you can do that. So after you've completed this section, you can brag to people that I diagonalized by hand, analytically, a 256 by 256 matrix. It's pretty impressive. Now, when you get beyond n equals 2 and you go to higher numbers, you can't do it analytically anymore. And we do have some problems that we're going to talk about involving that. But before that, we have to then talk about, because we have these symmetries, how do you actually construct states that have these different kinds of symmetries? So there's a process and a procedure that you can go through in order to construct states that have definite z component of spin, definite total spin, definite z component of pseudospin, and definite total pseudospin. And the procedure by which you have to go through this is a bit complicated, and we talk a lot about that. And then we start talking about looking at larger clusters and how you would look at diagonalizing and working with those larger clusters. Next up is the Nagaoka theorem. The Nagaoka theorem tells us about ferromagnetism. And it's a beautiful proof. The idea is that you get the Hamiltonian matrix into a form where it is a positive or non-negative matrix. And then from that, we can apply the Perron-Frobenius theorem, and then you look at the consequences of the Perron-Frobenius theorem. Now we're at our small cluster calculations. We carefully go through and solve the three-site cluster and four-site cluster models. This involves a lot of work, and we used a computer to actually generate a number of the states that we work with in this model because it's kind of difficult to do it all by hand. But once you have the states, then you can work with them and construct the Hamiltonian matrix. And that's the kind of work that you'll be doing when we look at these kinds of small cluster calculations. It's a bit tedious, and it's a lot of work. And I still think, though, that you get some interesting insight into many-body physics and the many-body problem when you get your hands down and dirty and really look at and work through these kinds of problems. So I think it's a worthwhile exercise for you to do. And this is something that we talk about in this section. You can see these states get complicated and long. There's sort of no way of reducing that issue. Then we look at the Lieb theorems and spin reflection positivity. This is an absolutely beautiful way of thinking about it. Lieb had an interesting construction that he used for how to represent the eigenstates of the Hubbard model by matrices. And then by working with properties of the matrices, he could prove results about the Hubbard model. So one of the results is when the Hubbard interaction is actually attractive rather than repulsive, All ground states when I have an even number of electrons have spin zero. That's a pretty cool result. But then what he showed, he could show that at half filling on a bipartite lattice for the repulsive case, the spin was always a singlet and there was never any level crossing in the ground state. And that's like a super powerful theorem that he proved. There are lots of steps to this theorem. I carefully go through them step by step with you. As a bit of an anecdote, I will share with you that I did work with Elliot Lieb on a follow-up problem for this. We proved some results about the Holstein model. And there was a technical aspect of his original proofs that he didn't put in his paper, and he actually thought for a while that maybe he had got it wrong. So we actually put those details into the paper that I wrote with him. And this is a figure that is illustrating that exercise that we go through. It's, again, it's really beautiful mathematics to see the way in which all of this fits together. And I give you a chance to really experience this by going through all of these results in great detail in this section. After completing this work, Elliot Lieb had proposed a type of lattice that's a bipartite lattice but has a different number of sites for each of the two sublattices, and those are now called Lieb lattices in honor of him. And there's a lot of interesting things about those lattices. They have a macroscopic number of states that have zero energy, and that leads to interesting magnetism and other kinds of behaviors. So there's a number of condensed matter physicists who've been spending their careers studying properties of electrons on these so-called Lieb lattices. Then we get into the spin towers and pseudo-spin towers. This is work that has been partially proven, but there still are some aspects that remain that haven't been fully established. So if you have a good idea about how to do that, going through this paper will give you an option to, you know, write a paper up and show everyone how the rest of this works. I think it's really interesting and cool stuff, and I think you're going to enjoy looking at how you can get these kinds of rigorous results about a model that is seemingly intractable to solve. In this problem that I'm scrolling through right now, we spend a fair amount of time looking at how you solve things from this Lieb perspective of working with these matrices that represent the different quantum mechanical states. And that is the end of the chapter. Hey guys, let's do quantum right.